Good morning. It is my pleasure this morning to introduce our speaker for this session, Justice Helen Ogunwumiju from Nigeria. She assures me that I said that correctly, and I avoided biting my tongue while I was trying to do it. And probably all of you, or most of you, attended the session, the plenary session that she participated in. So you know something of her. I was particularly impressed when Judge Wallace told us that she had raised seven sons. I don't know if this is true of your culture, but in our culture there is a legend or a myth or what have you that the seventh son of a seventh son has medicinal powers. I knew a seventh son once, and his parents named him Doctor. I know that her biography, or a very short biography, along with the other speakers listed in the materials, and I know you all have the materials, I also suspect that you haven't read all of those biographies, so if you'll permit me, I would like to read hers. She graduated from the University of Lagos. She was called to the Nigerian bar in 1978 and has since served on the Ministry of Justice, YOLA, in the Legal Aid Council, on the Legal Aid Council for, is it Ibadan and Sokoto? And as the Assistant Director of Legal Aid in the Lagos Zone, she was Chief Magistrate, Oyo State, and Chief Registrar, High Court, Oyo State, as well as Judge on the High Court for Ondo State. She currently serves as a Justice for the Court of Appeal. She is a member of the World Jurist Association and of the Commonwealth Judges and Magistrates Association, and is President of the National Association of Women Judges, Nigeria. She obviously hasn't had a great deal of spare time between raising seven sons and all of the things that she has done. We are honored to have her here, and I'm sure you are interested in finding out how things are in Nigeria and what they do there and how they do them. She has, we will obviously be able to ask her some questions about what she's going to talk about, but she also authorized me that if you have lingering questions from the plenary session that she participated in, feel free to ask her questions about that as well when she finishes. Madam Justice.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My lords, we are using to say, my lords, we still subscribe to the British tradition of calling judges. My lords, my ladies, my lords here, good afternoon. It's my pleasure and privilege to be here. And I'm grateful for this opportunity to attend and actively participate in this symposium. I thank Koldoam Jr. in absentia. I met him last February in Lagos, at the Lagos UNILAC symposium, similar to this. So it was like a teaching symposium for students of and faculty of UNILAG. And I congratulate the Institute on the good work it's been doing. I have a very small presentation here, basically about the interplay between religion, rule of law, and social stability in Nigeria. The Black's Law Dictionary defines religion as a system of faith and worship involving belief in a supreme being, and usually containing a moral or ethical code. The same dictionary defines law as a body of rules, standards, and principles that the courts of a particular jurisdiction apply in deciding controversies brought before them. Religion has always been a part of law. Most of our laws are derived from the religion of the founding fathers of the nations for whom the laws were made. Laws are usually derived from scripture, tradition, and reason. Throughout the history of mankind, law has been influenced by religion. Law also embodies principles of equity and good conscience. In short, the values and morals of society. No doubt, morality plays an important role in regulating social relations that maintain social order. Even though morality and law have different identities, where morality conflicts with law, the law must prevail. Religious sentiments must also be distinguished from the law. In the celebrated case of Thomas versus Olufosoye, the Supreme Court of Nigeria held that a mere church member had no locus to challenge the appointment of, by the House of Bishops of a bishop for the See of Lagos in the Anglican Communion. The court, in appreciating the dichotomy between law and religious sentiment, held as follows, quote, "What is very important in the case is the danger of bringing religion as such to the reasoning of jurisprudence. The reasoning in religion is one of God or Allah, which passeth all jurisprudential understanding. The more so when Christian judges have to be called upon to settle Muslim disputes, or Muslim judges adjudicate upon Christian issues. The unbeliever in such cases can only apply the law of the state. Such, since Aquinas' Summa Theologica, jurisprudence as legal reasoning within the confines of law itself has not been coterminous with religious philosophy. Yet, judges, once they are seized of a matter, have no choice but to apply the law and not religious sentiments. Perhaps religionists would assist themselves more by devising a forum for settlement of their disputes and come to court only when that fails, for legal locus standi may not be the same to a believer as it is to a lawyer," unquote. No doubt, law is a vital tool in safeguarding freedom of religion or freedom not to believe in any religion. Protection of religion by the law is universal. Laws of non-secular countries protect the religion of the state from perceived apostasy and not individual right to religion. I want to depart from my written text to bring this issue to the fore. You know that I'm an Anglican. I'm the chancellor of the Ibadan Diocese of the Anglican Communion. You know, the Anglican Communion in Nigeria departed from the English Church on the issue of the recognition of gay priests by the Anglican Communion. There was a big furor over it. And now, when priests, I have to administer the oath, the canonical oath, to the priests when they have been ordained. And it had the oath that they are now compelled by the Church of Nigeria, Anglican Communion, to swear to an additional oath to say they have never been homosexuals and they will never be homosexuals. Yes. No one has challenged this. I guess they have to challenge the church authority. But as a member of the body of laity and as a chancellor, at one of the meetings of the laity and the House of Bishops and the House of Laity, which we attend about two or three times a year, I brought this up. And I mentioned the unconstitutionality of forcing priests to take that oath. And I was met with such ferocious antagonism that I had to back off. I just backed off. And it has remained like that. And I'm waiting for somebody to speak up. I doubt if that will happen soon. So that at least I can have someone to champion. But for now, I'm just a lone voice in the wilderness. If you follow world news, you will understand that the theme of this symposium encapsulates what is happening now in my country, in Nigeria. I will talk briefly about religion, rule of law, and situate this topic in the context of the Nigerian state. Nigeria is multilingual, multi-ethnic, multi-religious. We are estimated to be about 170 million. We have the last black population in the world, and 70% of Nigerians can read and write at least one language. The two major religions are Islam and Christianity. Both religions were imported into the first homogeneous entity called Nigeria, Islam by the jihadists from North Africa, and Christianity by the missionaries who came along with the traders and later the colonialists from Europe. Presently, the grand norm of Nigeria is the third Republican Constitution of 1999 with subsequent amendments. The Constitution did not state specifically that Nigeria is a secular state. However, Section 10, in terse words, just one line, prohibits both the state and federal governments from adopting any religion as a state or federal religion. Section 38 guarantees freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. Section 42 guarantees the right to freedom from discrimination in any form, specifically names religion. An interesting non-justiciable part of the Constitution is Chapter 2. This is called the Fundamental Objectives and Directive Principles of State Policy. Section 17, subsection 3 of it enjoins, among other things, that the state should provide facilities for free religious life. In short, freedom of religion and expression of religious faith is provided for by the Constitution. There seems to be an understanding, in view of the elaborate constitutional evidence, of an unambiguous intention to separate state affairs from religious creeds, that Nigeria can safely be described as a moderately secular nation. The issue of whether Nigeria is secular or not, I mentioned it at the plenary yesterday. Our Muslim brothers and sisters don't seem to want that, the word secular to mean godlessness. But I think we are happy with the way the Constitution is presently crafted. And I would like to mention that 12 of the northern states adopted some form of Sharia into their criminal statutes, criminal law in some areas. The Constitution also recognizes the fact that three concurrent systems of law coexist in Nigeria: the inherited common law and equity principles on one hand, and statutes promulgated by the state or national legislative houses on the other hand. Then second, customary law. And third, Sharia law. These are the three sources of Nigerian law. The public and judicial office holders in Nigeria must take the oath of office with either the Holy Quran, the Holy Bible, or by affirmation, or by holding up anything that they believe in. And they must swear to the oath of allegiance to the Federal Republic. The Constitution goes further to provide for the establishment of the customary court of appeal for each state, appeals from which lie to the court of appeal, where I serve. There's a provision also for the Sharia court of appeal, appeals from which lie to the court of appeal. And the Sharia Court of Appeal, has limited jurisdiction in regarding Islamic personal law, Muslim marriage, family relationship, guardianship of infant, the waqf, the gift, will or succession, maintenance of a person with physical or mental disability. Special panels are usually constituted within the justices of the Court of Appeal, consisting of justices learned in Islamic law, to hear and determine appeals from the Sharia Courts of Appeal. So the Nigerian Constitution has been able to interweave the law of the land with the different religions or belief systems of the generality of the people. The Constitution is an embodiment of the spirit of all the international statutes in relation to Declaration of Human Rights and Sections 33 to 48 embody all these fundamental principles. The question now arises as to how the elaborate provisions of the previous and present Nigerian constitutions have helped to promote social cohesion and stability, since the interests of every major religious and cultural groups have been recognized. In my complex country, there are many Christians in the predominantly Muslim North, and there are many Muslims in the predominantly Christian South. So you cannot be separated by geography. It's not that it is the totally Muslim North or the totally Muslim South, no, totally Christian South. Because I'm in the federal court and we are liable to be transferred up and down, I've served in most of the zones of the country. And there's no where, there's no state in Nigeria where you say this in this state, everybody there, indigenous or living in that state, are Christians. Or everyone here, indigenous or living in that state, are Muslims. There's no doubt that we had a period of military interregnum in which there were successive military governments, and they condoned and encouraged legitimate influence of religion on state affairs in order to gain political legitimacy and shroud themselves in religious sanctity. But however, since the 1999 constitution and the entrenchment of democracy and the rule of law, overt religious incursion into governance has decreased considerably. The courts have also played a notable part in the entrenchment of the rule of law by deciding controversial constitutional issues relating to law and religion in a way that left everyone in no doubt as to the separation of law and religion. In 2009, the Court of Appeal, Ilorin Division, decided that the university was right to refuse the wearing of the full hijab by female students, which covered their faces and prevented examiners from seeing their faces before they entered the examination halls. At that time, there was a move. At that time, something interesting happened in composing the panel for that case, because it was a very sensitive issue, the use of the hijab. There was no opposition to the use of the hijab as it were, but that any student entering an examination hall cannot wear the hijab that would cover and just show the eyes. And the students insisted on this. They failed at the High Court and appealed to the Court of Appeal. And whenever the case came up, we had to get police to come and keep order. Not that there was any, it wasn't a Christian Muslim thing. It was the school administration versus students, the student body. So there was a debate as to whether to constitute a Sharia panel for this, to determine this issue. But reason won out, and it was decided that this was strictly a constitutional issue. Freedom of movement and freedom to wear what you wish when you wish. It was purely a constitutional issue. So an ordinary panel of five justices was constituted, and they determined and affirmed the judgment of the High Court that the student did not have the right, given the circumstances, that the university authorities needed to identify and be sure of the student actually entering the examination hall, that there was no violation of the right of the student to wear what she wished to wear. So there was no appeal against that judgment by the Court of Appeal. And in another interesting matter, the Medical and Dental Practitioners Disciplinary Council suspended a medical doctor who had refused to administer life-saving blood who did not, I don't want to use the word refuse, that's not what happened. There was a doctor, there was a Mrs. Martha something, forgotten. She was a Jehovah Witness. And she had a baby and she lost a lot of blood. And she needed blood transfusion. The doctor also was a Jehovah Witness. She refused blood transfusion. She was discharged and she was rushed back to the hospital. And the doctors did not force her to take blood transfusion. And she died. Her husband was not a Jehovah Witness. So he reported the doctor to the Medical and Dental Practitioners Disciplinary Tribunal. And the tribunal suspended him. And appeals from such tribunals come to the Court of Appeal and then to the Supreme Court. At the Court of Appeal, the court agreed with the tribunal. And their reason was that it must have been because he was also a Jehovah Witness that he agreed not to give her life-saving transfusion. But the Supreme Court disagreed with the Court of Appeal and held that since the woman knew, an adult of over 21, appreciated the fact that her life was in danger and still refused blood transfusion because of her religious beliefs, that it would have been wrong of the doctor to force her to take blood transfusion. So, and the sanction against the doctor was, of course, struck out. And I must also mention the issue of the law against homosexuality in Nigeria. The law was passed about a year ago, and nobody has challenged it yet, so we don't know what the Supreme Court, what we would be asked, the issues that would be raised concerning it, and what the Supreme Court would finally say, because it's a very strong constitutional issue. And then I took up, she's here. I took up Rosalind after her paper, and thank God she's here. And I wanted to explain some things about the issue of religion and the flashpoints of social tensions in Nigeria. What usually happens in Nigeria, even in Jos, where the problem, for example, in Jos is a typical example, and I refer to Jos because she mentioned Jos. The people who settled in Jos are Christians, and they have these Muslims who came in as their overlords and who are Fulani cattle rearers. So usually, the problem will start as a problem of quarrel over land, over grazing land, over trespass to land, usually. In fact, some of the more ferocious flashpoints of problem in the north would start with neighbors in a house. Oh, we are we are two women. We are quarreling over who gets to fetch water at the tap first. I'm a Muslim, we are a Christian, and we fight, there's a small quarrel, and I go home to report to my Muslim husband, and she goes home to report to her Christian husband. It did not start out as, oh, I hate you because you are a Christian, or I hate you because you are a Muslim. No quarrel in Nigeria that I know of has ever started that way. It always starts with something totally different from religion. And then religion is now used as a cover. And everyone now gathers supporters for their own point of view or for their own cause, because that is where you can get sympathy. It's not easy to get sympathy. Oh, I'm Yoruba, I'm Igbo. You get it from, oh, see what that Muslim woman said to me, or see what that Christian woman said to me, and then you get sympathy, and then before you know it, everything gets out of control. And then there's the big fight, and it turns into, and usually the source of the quarrel is forgotten.
So I just wanted to make that point. And usually there's no grand conspiracy by any group of Christians or any grand conspiracy by any group of Muslims to attack the other side. It has never happened. What usually happens is that something minor, something, it may not be minor, it may be minor to us, but it might be a big deal to the people who are quarreling, maybe over land, usually over land. For example, the four of us here representing Nigeria happen to be Yorubas, so we know and we can remember the Ife Mudakeke quarrel, which lasted for about 3 years, and they decimated the whole town. And they are both, it was not a religious quarrel, but they both are the same people, but they claim as different ancestry, and they decided to quarrel, and the quarrel was unending for 3 years. They held the whole Southwest to ransom for 3 years. So it had nothing to do with religion. That one had to do with land. Most of the time, most of these quarrels have different reasons based on property rights and all that. I just wanted to make that point. One had hoped, you know, that the elaborate provisions in the Constitution would suffice to satisfy religious and ethnic groups, and that the issue of exclusion would not rear its head. And I would like to talk about Boko Haram. I mentioned them yesterday. The sect says that Western education is haram, that is, it is forbidden. At the onset, it was thought that the sect seeks a pristine Islamic state in Nigeria. However, its motives are now shrouded in mystery because, you know, they attack Muslims praying inside mosques, they attack Christians praying inside churches, and over 20,000 Nigerians have been killed, and it has become our country's major security challenge. The good thing about it is that the killing of thousands of Nigerians has jacked from inertia all the politicians and religious leaders in Nigeria to dialogue and cooperative action in order to stem the excesses of the sect. And as I said yesterday at Pinari, I work with at least 50 Muslim brothers and sisters in the Court of Appeal, and none of them can explain. They all agree, and any common man in Nigeria would agree there's no justification for the criminality perpetrated by Boko Haram on the Nigerian people. We are still agonizing over the abduction of 300 Chibok girls, which is still an open sore that weeps to the consciousness of Nigerians. And reports from the various refugee camps where the women have been interviewed show that some of those rescued have been raped, have been forced to convert to Islam in order to survive. However, the Nigerian people are determined not to allow religious conflict to divide us and will continue to maintain the cohesion and social stability of the Nigerian nation. I would like to say a word or two about my work with, as the president of the National Association of Women Judges. The association was started 25 years ago to promote the education of young girls to ensure that there was gender parity in the appointment of female judicial officers, etc., etc. Our pet project, one of our pet projects, has been on the issue of rape, defilement, abduction, and kidnapping. We've done a lot of work on that. We've got the state and federal government to take policy decisions in respect of how they treat these cases. I've been able to get the Inspector General of Police to set up a special victims unit in all the police stations in the country, so that when particularly issues of defilement, and you know our own culture, the shame of coming out to say, oh, I've been raped, I've been defiled, is unimaginable. So we've set up support groups to support these women and to ensure that they do come out, they do give evidence, and we are training police officers. That's our major work with the bar. We are training police officers who are the first to see the victims to ensure that evidence is not lost. Because first of all, even if the victim is ready to prosecute you, there must be evidence on which the court can decide one way or the other. Most of the evidence is lost due to lack of education and sensitization of the police officers. The system is not as advanced as it is here. We watch it on television, but that is all that it is. So it's so out of our league, you know. But we are trying as much as possible to see what we can do so that we can bring some of these ideas that we've learned from interaction abroad, and then trying to educate our police officers and trying to change the mindset of our police officers. And I would like to say that, because I know that when the questions come rolling in, I might lose this opportunity, I might lose this train of thought. I would like to say that I've benefited immensely from this symposium. I am happy that my reluctance not to come did not overbear my reasons for coming. As I sat there listening to Rosalind, it occurred to me what could be done. And I'm going to make the effort, I promise. Because a lot of effort has been put into organizing these things. And it would be a great shame if we all go back and nothing, there's no catalyst, there's nothing. You just go back and then there's life as usual when you go back home. I promise that I would reward, as it were, the efforts that have been put by making sure that I go back home and speak to those that are concerned. That we need in Nigeria, we need to start educating children about coming together, about understanding each other, and at all levels of society, using the press, using the schools, because these things develop because we are not educated enough to realize that nothing is solved by fighting. Nothing is solved by any form of criminality. Even those who fight over mundane things and then they end up escalating it and thousands of lives are lost, is because they have not been educated to realize that you do not need to escalate these things, these issues. They need not be escalated to be. It's not as if other developed countries where issues don't get out of control, it's not as if they don't have such issues. Neighbors have issues. There's issue over land, there's issue over this, there's issue over that. But because they have been educated to know that this can be settled amicably by dialogue, and it is part of their orientation, they don't resort. The first resort is not to violence. So it's something that I will take back home, and I will try as much as possible to tell the powers that be that there must be a formal policy to educate most Nigerians at school level, school level up to university about this reason to dialogue. Thank you very much.
And thank you very much. Questions? Yes.
Well, thank you for making that choice and weighing the pros and the cons in favor of the pros and being with us here today. That's very nice of you to come and share your insights about your country and its people. I feel a sense of kinship almost with the people of Nigeria, mm-hmm. which I've never felt before. So thank you for that. I would be interested to know if there is any effort in the traditional Muslim community or the churches to disavow what is happening with Boko Haram. And there, I mean, if I understand it correctly, Boko Haram pretends to be a Muslim-based mm-hmm. operation, right? Mm-hmm. But I also believe that the Muslim community in general would say, no, that's mm-hmm. that's not what we believe. Mm-hmm. What is, are they doing anything about that within the religious community?
I think that has been a vexed issue. And that has caused a lot of resentment in the minds of the Christians over time. Usually when there are these flashpoints of religious violence, particularly in the north, which usually start with having nothing to do with religion or Islam. It ends up becoming a religious issue. And there's a lot of killing on both sides. In the north, if it's in the north, the Christians get more killed. If it's in the Middle Belt, the Muslims get more killed. But no one, it is just in recent times when things got out of control of everybody, that people are actually having the courage to step out, to condemn one side, or condemn their own side, to say, oh, that was excessive, that was unnecessary. But it had gone on for too long before people started speaking out. It had gone on for too long. There had been isolated incidents, you know, and people would keep quiet to be reported. If it was the Christians that killed the Muslims, it would be that, they've been doing it. When are we going to? The Bible says when you are slapped on one cheek, you turn the other cheek. No, we are not going to follow that portion of the Bible again. We are not going to agree. And then if it's the Muslims, they will say, we'll pay you back. You know, so most of the religious leaders have not been doing their duty. They have hidden behind, I'm trying to choose my words very carefully because there are Muslim leaders here. they have hidden behind, I don't know. But suffice it to say that they abdicated their duty to society. But now that things seem to have gotten out of hand, they are coming forward. Things have improved in the last 2 years. The Sultan is roundly condemning the Boko Haram and where there's a clash, and it seems as if the Christians were unduly manipulative of the situation, the Christian church has also come forward to roundly condemn such actions. I think I can leave that answered as that.
Thank you. Yes, mm-hmm. Professor.
Yes.
thank you very much, Justice Helen. You have been one of the high points of this symposium for me. So I'm especially honored that you cite my talk and the fact that this is an appetizer to the conversations that and the maybe the projects that we're going to now get involved in as a result of meeting here. And I agree with you. It's so important to not just go back and get caught up in our routines and everything, but to try to build on what we've learned and who we've met here. So if I may say, and I think Sean has gone, but we hope that you will be able to attend the African Consortium on Law and Religion Studies in Addis Ababa in May, so that maybe we can have a panel, as we talked earlier, about religion and hate speech in Africa. So this is needed, and you will bring that much-needed legal perspective to this conversation. Now, let me just quickly respond to some of your reflections on what I was, what you thought I was hinting at. Now, I would agree with you that many conflicts, minor or major in Nigeria, may begin over the selling of meat, too much noise or something. They could be very minor issues that spark you know, major crises. And that my point is that now with the modern media, with phones, with text messages, I mean, this is only going to escalate the situation if, unless, as you suggest, religious leaders or political leaders come together and try to stamp out these, you know, these uncontrolled responses, as they tried to do in Tanzania. However, and you know, and to reflect that not all crises and conflicts in Nigeria deserve the label of religious violence. Nowhere in my work, and I've written extensively on these issues, do I use that label religious violence, because it just masks the ethnic tensions that you point to. So that is why I refer to it as religiously related conflict and violence. Religiously related, because as you rightly say, religion may come in. That said, there have been incidents in Nigeria, some very deadly, which did start out with people responding on the basis of being offended religiously by what they heard, say on a camp. A lot of these begin on campuses. So I agree with you that the education sector in Nigeria is perhaps needs a boost in terms of what it is doing in that regard. So I support that completely, and I would strongly recommend that perhaps you look to some other countries that have worked on this, say South Africa, because they have a lot in their education system to address these issues at the present time, right? Some of this has been done before, decades ago, but we need to update it. It needs to be, we need to be using modern media in order to do this. So thank you for your efforts so far, and I look forward to working with you in any way possible.
Thank you.
Yes.
Justice, thank you for the presentation.
I feel like a lawyer standing before the Court of Appeal with a bad brief. Now I know how they feel. Go on.
Justice, now when you made mention of a case of some bishops or somebody who are compelled to take oath about their being gay, sexualism, and so on, you are opposed to it. And my curiosity is this. From your own personal experience as a judge and somebody involved in church matters, does this church have rules and regulations that govern it, or the affairs of the church is governed by the constitution of the state? So what informed your decision, your stand?
That's a very interesting question. The church has its own laws, canonical law, constitution. Each diocese the Anglican, the Church of Nigeria has its own constitution. Each diocese has its own constitution. And the issue of homosexuality was something that was not acknowledged. So it never arose. The issue of recognizing or disrecognizing it or not recognizing it was not an issue in religion because it was not acknowledged. The penal code in the north makes homosexual, it's called, what do you call it now? Is it sodomy? Sodomy. Yeah, a crime. In the south, it's called homosexuality is a crime in the criminal code already. Before that special legislation that came in last year. And for me, it just reinforced, you know, there was a big quarrel by the Church of Nigeria with Canterbury over this. The bishops of the Church of Nigeria felt that they could no longer have communion with the Church of England if they were to ordain gay priests, and that it was for us, for the Church of Nigeria, culturally, morally, biblically wrong to ordain gay priests. So it was as a result of that break, that quarrel with Canterbury, that it was part of the executive orders of the Archbishop of the province of Nigeria made the order that before a priest in Nigeria could be ordained to take the oath to the church, he must, after taking that oath, also take the oath that had never been homosexual, and he will never be a homosexual. So the reason why, as a law person, as a lawyer, my instinct is to say, what right have you? That was my instinctive reaction. I felt it wasn't needed. I felt it was unnecessary. And I still feel so strongly that it's not necessary for them to take that oath. Not that I'm taking a stand one way or the other. And I'm not going to tell you if that matter were to come before me, how I would rule. But I just feel that going that one step further to make them swear to that oath is unnecessary. That's how I feel.
I'm glad that this conversation is happening. Mm-hmm. Here are my thoughts and then my question quickly. The reason why the African Anglican Communion dissociated themselves from the one in Canterbury was on the case of having homosexual priests. And no doubt the clergy of Anglican in Africa, they are acting out the sentiment of the people. As you said in your paper, that laws come from reasoning and of course from the collective morality, experience and morality of the people. If the culture and the thinking of the people is the one that the clergy stood by in getting out, and now they made they included something that is not there before, perhaps because it's never thought of. Because as a matter of fact, I can walk down the street of any Nigerian city holding a male's hand without anybody thinking.
Nobody will even occur to anybody.
Okay. So, but now that issue had come to the fore.
Yes.
Will it not be appropriate to use your position to help those clergy to now rethink that this is not in your constitution before? Perhaps you need to bring it. Otherwise, you cannot do it. What would you do to help them, at least at the moment? I can remember when it came up in the Senate. Mm-hmm. There was a senator that kind of, if you will recall, was sympathetic to the LGBT group. He was nearly lynched in his community. He has to deny, and in our culture, to prostrate, lie in total submission to the will of the people, and say it doesn't mean that he meant something else.
He had to recant.
He had to totally recant and prostrate with his chest on the ground and apologize to the community he was representing. So I think it will help the Anglican Communion to revert crisis, because I want to believe that if they discover an homosexual priest in an Anglican church, that church will be burnt down.
I'm sure.
And if the priest does not run, he will be killed. So it is better to avert a religious crisis before it happens. Mm. What would you do to help that purpose?
I don't really understand the question, but if let me try and see what you're trying to say. Done to help the priests?
Because when they brought up that oath, that people should swear an oath that they are not and they will never be.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps my understanding is your objection was because it wasn't there before.
No.
Now they are introducing
it. My instinctive reaction is just that, why must you subject them to take an oath? That's my reaction. Simpliciter. Why must you subject them to that oath? Why is it necessary to subject them to that oath?
Now there is, as the leader, you hold a view.
Mm-hmm.
And as a group, they hold a
view. And I was very careful.
Should you have followers, that will create a faction and a problem in the future.
I was very careful.
Sometimes I want to stand up and say this respectively. I used to tell lawyers I don't like lawyers.
Please sit
because
down.
They complicate issues. And judges more so. Their rulings, I understand, follow the law and not sentiment. And many rulings are seen by the people not to be in the interest of the people.
Uh-huh.
And I think as a judge and as a lawyer, there is a need to create work. Mm-hmm. So that the profession will listen. That
he
is
has
the
found us out.
Sentiment of a layman. But can you help, knowing that Nigeria can have flashpoint on this issue in future, mm-hmm. to avert it ab initio before it even becomes an issue, using
an
your
issue.
Position to help? That is my question. What can you do to that effect? Would you be willing to do that?
Is it to help the church? Is it to help the church to avert a future onslaught of homosexuals in the church, or to help would-be homosexuals?
To help define.
Uh-huh. So because
that will govern the church.
Okay. To amend the constitution in such a way. I'm trying to understand. I'm trying to get you right. Is it to ensure that the constitution of the Church of Nigeria is amended in such a way that it's receptive?
It reflects their leaning towards non-Christians.
Yes.
So it may not be an issue of votes if necessary, or may not cause a dissension.
It's not likely to cause a dissension. I just feel strongly that, why do you subject them to an oath? That's all. I just feel you have no right to force them to an oath, because that was not the basis. The basis of their being called as priests is to obey God, to serve the people. That's the basis of their being called as priests. And then you now say, you now take it a step further. At the point they are being ordained, and you now say, come and swear to an oath that you have never been a homosexual and you will never be a homosexual.
Excuse me, you can't stand up until you recognize.
I just don't like the oath.
Well, I think we went to, we go to a quarter after 12.
Yes.
And our time is gone. And I think we could be here for some time. And I hate to stand between anybody and lunch.
Yes.
And so I think, thank you, Helen.
Escape at last.
We appreciate your willingness.
Yes.
I will rescue her from further yes. discussion.
Yes.
It obviously, and I think, as the judge said, starting this out, for the rest of us who've not been involved with this in Nigeria, I think we've come away with a better understanding and particularly appreciation for Nigeria, its people, its judiciary, and the efforts that are being made to accommodate people, their beliefs, and their rights at the same time. And so, thank you very much.
I
think she deserves another hand.
Thank you very much.